Mohammed Noor, thanks so much for coming on to Evolution Soup from your home in North Carolina. You are a professor of biology at Duke University involved in evolutionary genetics research, looking into how genetic changes contribute to the formation of new species. A keen Star Trek aficionado, you are the author of the book Live Long and Evolve, as well as serving as a science advisor on the Paramount Plus series Star Trek Discovery. So how are you doing, Mohammed? I know you've been busy with podcasts lately, including hosting your own two series on YouTube, one of which you hosted with Star Trek Discovery's Jane Brooke. So how have they been received?
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be on the show. I love your show. I think the series have been received pretty well. I mean, I didn't really know what to expect going into the process. I started my main YouTube series, BioTrekkie Explains, a little bit over a year ago. It was in April 2020. It was, I guess, kind of a pandemic project, but this was coming off having spoken on the Star Trek cruise and seeing, you know, a lot of excitement about hearing scientific concepts being relayed in the context of Star Trek and seeing a lot of enthusiasm for that. I spoke with some folks at CBS just to make sure I wasn't going to get in trouble and asked, what do you think about my starting a series along these lines? And I got a green light on that. And that's been going pretty well. I mean, pretty consistently get a couple hundred views for each video, which, I mean, that's about what I expected. I'm no movie star, so it's not going to get in the tens of thousands ever or anything like that. But then I guess in September or October, I reached out to my friend and colleague, Jane Brooke, who, as you mentioned, plays Admiral Katrina Cornwell in Star Trek Discovery, and asked her if she'd be willing to go through episodes with me. And that was so much fun. We actually recorded all of them as they aired. So as we were doing them, I didn't know what the next episodes were going to be like. So we recorded those as we went along and then aired those in January and February. I couldn't air them as they were going because my non-disclosure agreement said I couldn't discuss the season at all until the season had concluded. So we did the first episode after the season finale had come out. But yeah, very, very good positive comments on the videos online. Decent following, it seems like. So I'm very happy, and I had a ton of fun. Oh my gosh, Jane is phenomenal.
Onward and upward.
Yep.
Well, this is going to be a little bit different for Evolution Soup. We'll talk about evolution, of course, but through the lens of the 50-year-old Star Trek franchise, and if its take on science and evolution was up to scratch. But before we warp into that discussion, let's just hear a bit more about you. Mohammed, did you always enjoy science, and how did that interest lead you to where you are now?
I had always been a big science nerd. I mean, all the way back to middle school, I used to say I loved biology. And actually, I found one of my middle school yearbooks, and one of my friends, Donnie, had written in there, "Someday you'll be a biologist." And I was like, "Hey, I actually did." But in college, you know, I started off as a biology major. Actually, I was doing both biology and psychology because I wasn't entirely decided. But it was really when I took genetics that really caught my eye. I was like, wow, this is really exciting. So I then, after I took introductory genetics, I took this class called evolutionary genetics. Oh, I loved that class so much. I used to sit in the front row, probably because I couldn't see very well, but I always sit in the front row and I was just captivated the topic. I loved the sort of the combination of mathematical predictability to genetic changes over time and evolution, that I was absolutely sold on that. I ended up working with a professor who taught that class to do a research project. He introduced me to the person who then became my PhD advisor. So I applied to graduate school, went to the University of Chicago, did a thesis looking at how natural selection can drive mate preferences, you know, to basically make individuals of species preferentially want to mate with individuals of that same species rather than individuals of other species. So this was all using fruit flies, not using humans. So had a blast with that. And then from there went on, I did a quick postdoc at Cornell University. I had a faculty position for 7 years at Louisiana State University. That was a lot of fun there. And then while I was there, I applied for and got a job at Duke University, which was very much my dream job and still is. I'm very, very happy to be here. So now I actually have a research lab with, you know, a postdoctoral scholar, graduate students, undergraduates, lab managers, lab technicians. So it's a great team to work with. And one of the great things about academia is you get to like pick a team and you sit there and just work together as a team to try to solve these problems. And just day in and day out, like, what are we going to do? Like, what does this mean? And we try to interpret it. We have really, really fun interactions. So that's on the research side. And then meanwhile, I try to emulate my old undergraduate professor. His name was Professor Bruce Grant from William & Mary. I try to emulate him in the classroom and try to get other people interested in these topics as well.
And is it true, Mohammed, that one of your doctoral advisors was Jerry Coyne?
Yes, he was my doctoral advisor. He is the author of the book Why Evolution is True, which is a stellar book. I definitely strongly recommend people to read that.
And I think our Star Trek-minded viewers are going to want to know how it was you got this extremely cool gig of being science advisor on Star Trek Discovery.
Yeah, so actually there was quite a long path. So I guess it started in 2014 when I went to my first sci-fi convention. I'd never been to one, but my daughter Megan asked me if I wanted to go. So I went to Dragon Con in Atlanta. And I had a blast. It was, you know, it was a lot of fun. There were panels, but what surprised me, and I didn't know this existed, was that at conventions like this, there are science talks. And some of them are in the context of fandom. So my colleague here at Duke University, Professor Eric Spana, at that convention gave a talk on the genetics of wizarding in Harry Potter. And it was really an introduction to genetics, but using Harry Potter as a way of getting people into the topic. So that was fascinating. But actually, at the convention, there were just some straight up, you know, science talks or economics or other disciplines, things like that. So that was fascinating. So at that convention, I reached out to the Trek Track organizer at Dragon Con, who is Garrett Wong, who plays Harry Kim in Star Trek Voyager. Yeah, and I asked him if I could potentially do a talk on evolution as depicted in Star Trek. And he said, yeah, we're always looking for content like that. That would be great. So I did that starting in 2016. And then, you know, subsequently did that both at Dragon Con and other conventions. That then led to, there's a whole bunch of steps coming into it. That then led to the book that I wrote, because Princeton University Press reached out to me and asked me if I was willing to give a public outreach talk and write a book associated with it. And the public outreach talk I most often gave was basically Why Evolution is True. But as we just mentioned, my PhD advisor had written a book called exactly Why Evolution is True. There's no need for another one. I mean, that is absolutely perfect. I see no reason to try to replicate that or do something different from that. Yeah. So she asked me, is there something else you could write? And I said, well, there is some other kind of public talk I'm giving. It's a little different from what your press usually publishes. Yeah. That then led to this book, the Live Long and Evolve book. Mm-hmm. So that then, interestingly, so at, I think it was Dragon Con in 2019, I was giving a talk with my friend, Dr. Erin McDonald, who's an astrophysicist. And we'll probably come back to her in just a little bit too. And some of the Star Trek Discovery actors sat in the audience of that talk. Right, so this is Mary Chifo, who plays Klingon Chancellor Laurel, Ken Mitchell, who played Cole, and Jane Brooke, who played Admiral Katrina Cornwell. So we gave this talk on science as depicted in Star Trek Discovery. Neither of us had been associated with the franchise at that point. Just, you know, depictions from the first season. I can't remember if maybe the second season was in there or not. At the end of the talk, Jane came up to the front and said, hey, I'm a Duke alumni. I see you're at Duke University. We had a delightful chat. I gave her a copy of my book. We got to be friends. I actually invited her to come speak to my class at Duke University. So she came and talked there. But when she came, she brought her copy of the book and she had annotated it with all these wonderful questions and very, very insightful questions. And I mentioned to her, we talked about the questions and you know, addressing some of those kinds of things. But I talked about my interest in science advising and how I'd want to do that, but I didn't really have any idea how to do it. And she connected me with one of the writers in Star Trek Discovery. And then that is what eventually led to the consulting aspect. And I should stress that my role as a consultant is a contracted role. So Dr. Erin McDonald, she went through a similar process actually around the same time. She is actually the science advisor for the Star Trek universe. So she is on retainer by Paramount Plus to do these things across all the different series. I like to say she's the sheriff of science in Star Trek. Whereas I'm somebody who's occasionally deputized to come help out. But since she's an astrophysicist, her area is different from mine. So she'll sometimes shoot me an email or a text or somebody else from, say, Star Trek Discovery. As you know, I was associated with that. They would sometimes contact me and say, hey, we need help with this thing.
So. Right. So is it like clarification on something they're already working on? Or what is your take on something?
It could be that. Sometimes it's just like a couple of lines to say, is this verbiage okay? Sometimes it's more early stage where, for example, in season three, Dr. McDonald and I worked together on The Burn. And they had the idea of what The Burn was going to be in the sense that all dilithium was rendered inert. You know, this is getting into the weeds a little bit in Star Trek. I apologize. But they wanted some, they knew that it was somehow tied to this one individual, Sukal. And they wanted some way of tying together the biology and the physics so it didn't just sound completely absurd. Like, you know, can you get, and that's a tough one because to some extent that's not really possible. But we had to, you know, come up with something that had some basis in reality to go with it. And it was really fun getting to work with Erin since she was already a good friend of mine. So that was great.
Okay, let's leap into the world of evolution and Star Trek. Now, there have been seven Star Trek live action series throughout the years, all of which endeavor to tell stories using science in a futuristic context. Would you say, though, that each of the series reflected the scientific knowledge and discoveries of the particular era that they were made in?
Absolutely. So if you go back to the original series, this is from the 1960s. This is before we'd even, sequenced DNA. I mean, this is a, in terms of our knowledge of genetics, that it was very primitive at that point. And there's things in there, for example, in the episode Conscience of the King in the original series, they're trying to determine if one person there is somebody who they think he is. Rather than doing a DNA test, they do this voice print analysis, which, in terms of today, you would never do that. That's a ridiculous way of trying to figure out if somebody is a particular person or not. You would do a genetic test and it would be very straightforward. But again, it reflects the time. There were almost no mentions of the word DNA or gene or nucleotide. It almost never came up in the original series. As you get to Star Trek: The Next Generation, which you remember began in the late 1980s, you see a little bit of a step up. There's a couple of genetic tests in there. Some of the things are mentioned, and honestly, not always perfectly, but at least with good attempts. Now, Deep Space Nine curiously didn't have a lot of genetics. It was more focused on the battles and the politics and things like that, more so than just pure exploration. But that's fair. But Voyager, there was a dramatic step up. There was like all sorts of genetic tests being done. There were, references to dominance, recessivity. There was references to the word genome. The genome actually started being discussed. Timing for that's perfect because as Voyager is airing the late 1990s, the Human Genome Project is in full swing. You go to Enterprise, which 2001, 2005, the first human genome is published. We have a lot of analyses of DNA that are very, very in depth in some of the episodes there. And something like a quarter of the episodes mentions gene or genetics, and you see the word genome coming up a lot. And sometimes talking about the Suliban, or sometimes talking about individuals they'd encounter, or what's that name of the guy from the future, Crewman Daniels. But anyway, just a
Oh,
lot of genetics in
yes.
there. And then we have a little gap where there's not any Star Trek on TV until you get to Star Trek Discovery. Star Trek Discovery, though, whew, yeah, they dive right in. And this is prior to my involvement, so there's no credit to me on this, but they toss in concepts like horizontal gene transfer and mitochondrial DNA. It's like, okay, y'all are on it. So, yeah.
I suppose they know also that people can Google it and see if they're right.
Exactly. It's true. There was no Google in the late 1990s, at least to my knowledge.
So the fans are like fact-checking sort of like
Yeah.
as we go.
That's right. And it's easier for the writers too to look things up. I mean, they're not relying on America Online or whatever it was that they would have
Yeah.
used in that era.
Mohammed, when we think of Star Trek, we think of our heroes flying to planets not all that different from our own. In fact, some are almost identical, though that's probably, done for budgetary reasons, I would say. But is it possible that there could be planets out there where life evolved at least along similar lines to our own?
That's a great question. I mean, it's really hard to know because since we only have one known case of the origin of life, which is what we see
Well,
here, it's hard to know
yes, I
is
know.
what we see typical or is what we see completely anomalous. It's really hard to know. So, I mean, life on Earth is, water, it uses water as a solvent, it's carbon-based. There's some reasons those things would make sense. So, for example, carbon is a great element for being the basis for complex molecules because, from looking at its position on the periodic table, it can bind to four other atoms at a time, up to four other atoms at a time. That's good. I mean, that's good for making long chains and complicated things. Water is a good solvent because it's polar. It's very simple. It's just got two elements, one of which is hydrogen, which is the most abundant element in the universe. Oxygen is fairly abundant in the universe too. So all those things seem good, but it really, I mean, those are ideal for Earth. If we're looking at another planet, it's less obvious. For example, if Earth were much, much colder than it is, maybe something like liquid ammonia would make more sense as a solvent rather than water. And again, there are still just two elements, hydrogen and nitrogen, rather than hydrogen and oxygen. It's again polar. It has a lot of similar properties, but it's liquid at a much colder set of temperatures than water is. So some aspects maybe maintain, some not. Now, would we see, for example, as is often referred to, convergent evolution? Would we see like forms on another planet that look, irrespective of what they're made up of, but they might they look like the forms we see on Earth? I would say at a gross level, maybe. I mean, one of the biggest transitions that we have here on Earth, of course, is the origin of multicellularity. That, I mean, yes, Earth has tons of unicellular things, but when you think of Earth and when you see on Star Trek, you don't see the, you don't see the unicellular things so much, even though there's probably way, 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 way more of those than there are the multicellular kinds. But if you're thinking of something that looks like a tree or like a mushroom or like a person, you know, that's going to get harder. But on the other hand, natural selection isn't something that is based on the mode of inheritance. It requires inheritance, but it's not based on the mode of inheritance. So if there's a particular shape that allows one to go through water rapidly, so like the shape of a fish or a dolphin or whatever,
yes,
would something have that basic shape in some other liquid if it could achieve multicellularity? Highly probable the answer is yes. So I'd say at a crude level, yes. But as you get more and more into the fine details, it gets less and less likely.
I think of like land mammals that that went into the water and over 50 million years or so became the cetaceans. Something exactly. like that could happen if the conditions were right.
Yeah, exactly. That same sort of thing. Exactly.
And of course, the Star Trek crews are always meeting and working with beings who look a lot like them, beings they refer to as humanoids. Now, the original and Next Generation series both address this notion of there being a lot of humanoids in our galaxy and that they had been seeded across the planets by a master race. So what do you think of Star Trek's explanations on whether or not this is possible?
So a lot of people, when talking about this, first cite the episode from Star Trek The Next Generation called The Chase. So in that episode, they found a little bit of a code in the DNA of a lot of different living things. And they said this is somehow this ancient message. They dated the origin of all these things to 4 billion years ago, which is, you know, that's very accurate in terms of the origin of life on Earth. And at the very end, these DNA messages are brought together and that somehow it produces a video. A little unclear how that happens, but produces this video. And in the video, they hear the story about this ancient species that, as you said, seeded all these different planets. And eventually, you know, that is what led to the life forms that we see. And somehow or another, they were almost predestined in some way. That was a little bit cryptic. Almost predestined in some way to become, you know, the humanoids that we see now on, you know, Earth or the Klingon homeworld of Kronos or the Romulan homeworld of Romulus, all those different places. So that was an interesting idea. So again, the timing was good. You know, 4 billion years ago, origin of life on Earth. Yeah. And could it have been seeded from outer space? There's an idea called panspermia. I mean, we can't rule it out. It's quite possible either an original life form landed from outer space on Earth, and that's what did everything in some, you know, microbe. It's possible. Or maybe it may not even be that specific. Maybe just some raw material that was absent that facilitated the formation of life, or maybe even just rare, but facilitated the origin of life on Earth. That's feasible. The tricky thing there is it assumes this convergence over 4 billion years. So that assumes the role of random chance events being very, very, very low, right? But we know random chance events played a massive, massive role, at least for us here on Earth and probably for all species elsewhere. If you're looking over 4 billion years, that's a heck of a long time. Yeah. So on Earth, just as two examples, you know, a couple of billion years ago, we had the origin of the mitochondria from endosymbiosis. So this is, you know, one microbe essentially swallowed another microbe. It was able to get power from it, and that eventually became the organelle known as the mitochondria, the one that was ingested. And it provided power to the other cell. That very much facilitated the origin of multicellularity. So that is found in the ancestor of all fungi, plants, animals, et cetera. You know, did that happen around the same time in all these other different worlds? So looking much more recently, 65 million years ago, we have, you know, dinosaurs all over Earth. We have this asteroid impact. That's what knocks back, or part of what knocks back dinosaurs, along with volcanic activity happening at the same time. Did that happen on Kronos and Romulus?
I was just thinking that because we are, I guess, kind of a result of, you know, those little shrew-like animals finding their niche.
Exactly, exactly. And that niche had to be vacated, or not necessarily just niche vacated, but also just all these massive predators taken out to allow that radiation of the mammals. I don't know how that would have happened to all those other different worlds to at exactly the same time to lead to the same outcome. And that assumes, of course, that the environments, I mean, we're assuming the natural selection is identical in all these different worlds, which, I mean, there could be all sorts of other different pressures going on there that weren't happening on Earth. So I feel like that one's a long
shot. And I was thinking of sexual selection as well. You don't know what one animal is going to like looking at in the opposite sex. You know?
That's also true. Sometimes those are quite arbitrary. So that's problematic. But some of the other episodes tried to address it. So one in the original series, which again didn't succeed, but credit to the writers because they actually pointed out the flaw with it. The episode Return to Tomorrow. The Enterprise comes up to this planet, and there's these glowing orbs there, and one of them speaks and says, "I am Sargon. You know, our ancestors flew across the galaxy and spread their seed on different worlds. Perhaps your legends of an Adam and Eve were two of our travelers."
Oh, yes.
Right? So this sounds good in the sense of like, okay, so now we're starting actually with a humanoid rather than starting, because they said they looked like us too. That looks good, but then there's a big flaw with that one. And they pointed it out in the episode too. That would make it such that humans on Earth are not related to all the other species on Earth. Like if some humanoid landed, you know, a couple hundred thousand years ago, it's not related to trees and fungi. I mean, it's just going to be this completely unrelated organism. And we know that's not the case. So that, again, is a problematic. And the person who played Dr. Pulaski in Next Generation, she was actually an actress in that original series episode, but she called it out. She said, no, life on Earth evolved independently. So kudos to them for pointing that out.
Good old Dana Muldoor. Always,
yeah, exactly. That term. But the one episode which maybe got it right was the one called the Paradise Syndrome. So that's one where, you know, the Enterprise shows up on this planet. They beam down and they find these Native Americans. That was a little bizarre. Yeah. So the explanation that was raised in that episode was that a super race called the Preserver, I'm not sure what super race means, but the Preservers would basically go to different planets and take populations that were in danger of extinction and seed them elsewhere. So in that case, rather than aliens coming to Earth, it's more the, you know, Earth people being taken to other worlds. So setting aside the Native American part, because that's just weird. Imagine that happened instead with something like Homo erectus. You know, so we're going a little bit further back in our evolutionary history. Would then the individuals placed on other worlds evolve to look like a Romulan and maybe have pointed ears, or evolve to look like, at least maybe like an original series Klingon, or, you know, have some sort of, you know, phenotypic difference or some sort of, you know, trait difference? Yeah, that's quite possible. The other thing that opens up is if it's fairly recent ancestry like that, it's also quite possible that we would be interfertile with those aliens, which is something else we also see in Star Trek, that, you know, we see that humans and Vulcans are interfertile, at least with some effort, humans and Klingons. If it's a fairly recent ancestor, that's quite possible. Because, in fact, we know it did happen on Earth with regard to, say, for example, humans and Neanderthal. We, you know, you and I share some Neanderthal ancestry. You know, this also happened with another ancient hominid called the Denisovans. So, I mean, if it happened on Earth, it could happen then, you know, maybe just a tiny bit further back with some of these aliens. And it would be very testable. I mean, the way to test it would be you would get samples of DNA from human, Romulan, Klingon, Cardassian, whatever. All of us should be more similar in our DNA to each other than any of us is to chimp, for example, or gorilla.
Well, in the seventh season of Star Trek The Next Generation, there was an episode called Genesis. Now, this was a weird and creepy episode where the crew began to de-evolve, morphing into ancient evolutionary phenotypes like reptiles and insects. And this had something to do with T-cells and introns. Now, do you see this episode as just wacky pseudoscience, or was it perhaps a clever way of outlining our own evolutionary story?
That episode is complicated. So let me start with the most positive elements for it. So one of the most positive elements of it is it absolutely explicitly acknowledges that humans have evolved from other species, right? And that we share common ancestors with other species on Earth. So that aspect to it is strongly positive, because again, this is something that, you know, half of people in the United States, for example, don't really accept, or more than half of the people in the United States don't accept. So kudos to good science there. The de-evolution thing, I mean, to some extent, there's nothing really called de-evolution, because evolution isn't necessarily directional. It's not like it's always going this way. So if you go this way and then go that way, it's still just evolution, but they call it de-evolution. Could we come to look like an ancestral form again? Over evolutionary time scales, yeah, it's possible. I mean, using the example you raised earlier, just in terms of overall appearance, as you mentioned, the cetaceans look kind of like fish. Obviously, they're not related; they're not closely related to fish, but in terms of appearance, that's possible. The mechanism is problematic. But again, as with, and I'm sensitive to this now, given that I'm involved with the franchise, story will always trump science. We're not looking at episodes of National Geographic here. They have to have a plot, and things are going to have to happen that maybe can't happen.
Yes, as I know you've said, it's entertainment first and science second.
Exactly. So on that, what was it that they said their introns were activated, and that's what caused them to revert to these ancestral forms. So I think there is an error in terms of the use of the word introns. What I think they meant to refer to is what's called pseudogenes. So these are genes that used to have a function, but now no longer have a function. Mm-hmm. So that's a little bit different from an intron. An intron is like this little spacer thing within a gene.
More sci-fi though, introns.
It does sound more sci-fi. and you know, they're not necessarily completely separate from each other, but I think if I were writing it, and I probably wouldn't write that, but if I were writing it, I'd probably use pseudogene instead. The problem is going to be that although we carry pseudogenes, so genes that may have had a function, one of the pseudogenes that we humans carry is the one that produces vitamin C. I mean, this is one of the reasons we need vitamin C in our diet, because we don't actually have the functional gene that would produce it. Whereas, say, dogs, they're fine. They don't need vitamin C in their diet. They just make their own vitamin C. So the problem is, like, you can turn on our vitamin C gene, but it's broken. And this is going to be true for most pseudogenes. Since they've been functionless for a long time, mutations have come in there, and there's been no natural selection to stop those mutations from further destroying those sequences. So you can turn them on, but you're not gonna get the old form. It's gonna be it's very, very, very broken if it's even recognizable still as what that old gene was. So it was a good attempt on that front, but no, that doesn't really fly. There was another problem that happened there that they made the common evolutionary misconception of confusing ancestors with present day related species. So they did well with Riker, where Riker in that episode devolved, I still hate that term, but devolved into
Homo erectus type.
Yeah, right, exactly. Something more Homo erectus, like some, you know, more primitive primate ancestor. So fair enough. The one they really messed up was Barclay. Barclay devolved into a spider. We have no spider ancestors. We share ancestors with spiders, but none of our ancestors were spiders. Just like we share ancestors with our cousins, but our cousins are not our ancestors. So that was the misconception there. And similarly, like Spot the cat devolved into like an iguana. Like, what? No. Those are, you know, very advanced modern day species. So again, Spot would share an ancestor with it, but none of Spot's ancestors were iguanas.
Well, we can't talk about Star Trek without mentioning the cute and cuddly Tribbles. Now, even some non-Star Trek fans know what they are. These fuzzy little guys eat and reproduce like crazy and are, according to Dr. McCoy anyway, born pregnant. Now, is this just a fun idea, or do we see anything like this in nature?
Well, here's a little Tribble. You can hear its little sound going. It's a little Tribble.
I do indeed.
I'll go ahead and stop that. Tribbles are interesting. So these were introduced in the original series episode, The Trouble with Tribbles. And what was funny about them is, as you mentioned, their rate of reproduction, that they're born pregnant, things like that. But there's a point that actually I want to bring up about these Tribbles. Not only are they born pregnant, but McCoy referred to them as bisexual, reproducing at will. Now, an important thing, he didn't say they're asexual. So clones are asexual. So like, basically, like if you have a Tribble and it just produces a clone, like if I got an identical offspring that was another Tribble, you know, that genetically identical, that is, and maybe in terms of appearance too, that would be asexual. But instead, Tribbles are bisexual. So this one could be the offspring of this one, right? What happens when you're bisexual, you know, you can potentially reproduce with other individuals, but also you could be self-fertilizing. So maybe what's happening is, you know, the Tribbles inside them produce both sperm and eggs, and then they can self-fertilize. And what that allows is allows this opportunity for creating new genetic combinations. Just, you know, you're just mixing up your own genes, but maybe you can have, instead of, let's say, for example, big A and a little A, you can make something that has two big A's or two little A's. So you can get some individuals which are not identical. Now, that has a big evolutionary advantage. Even though they're still inbreeding by virtue of the fact that they're so fertilizing, you're still allowing some opportunity for generating new combinations. And that will allow more long-term potential for these species in terms of being able to survive over time, especially if they're producing tons and tons of offspring, as the Tribbles would do. Yeah. And there are some individuals in the real world that are, you know, quote-unquote bisexual and can self-fertilize. One example is the laboratory worm, Caenorhabditis elegans, or called C. elegans. It, you know, it comes actually in two forms. It can either be a male or it can be a bisexual form. But the bisexual one can just fertilize itself and produce more offspring. There's no intrinsic reason why that couldn't happen in utero, I guess. I mean, that doesn't happen with the worms, but there's no reason why that couldn't happen in utero. So, yeah, that's quite possible. Actually, I just want to give a quick shout out. This triple here was made by Science Division, and this is an app-enabled triple, if anybody's interested. Oh, wow. It's fantastic. I encourage you to follow them on social media and look at their products. They're really cool.
Cool.
It makes itself. I was doing it for my phone because my family's asleep and I didn't want to make too much noise. And they're a little loud.
If they scream, especially.
You know, especially if they scream, yeah.
They only scream if they see a Klingon. It makes you wonder if they were real, what evolutionary pressures would have caused them to become this self-fertilizing creature.
I mean, maybe they started that way. I mean, maybe some of our ancestors were self-fertilizing. It's unclear that they went from, you know, regular sexual or regular different sexes to self-fertilizing. Maybe they started that way. But yeah, I mean, one possibility is, of course, you know, if you can drop a triple on in a let's say, for example, they're very broadly dispersing. If they're self-fertilizing, they can just spread on their own and just do their thing and expand very quickly. They're not waiting for mates.
Yeah, they could take over an island or, well, probably a continent, actually, if they had it all to themselves. Mohammed, thinking back to the first five Trek series, which episodes of each would you consider their best biology shows?
Okay, I'm going to dodge the word best and just say like really good, because it's very hard to evaluate best. So for original series, I thought Devil in the Dark was very interesting, just that they explored this idea of silicon-based life forms rather than just carbon-based life forms. So that was interesting. And actually, some of the specifics that were mentioned in that episode were quite good. Like Dr. McCoy mentioned, well, this would be especially difficult in an oxygen environment. And that was actually a very good point, because, you know, long chains of carbons are fine when there's an abundance of oxygen, but silicon is much more likely to want to bind to oxygen than silicon. So that was spot on. I was very impressed catching that point. For The Next Generation, there's an episode called Up the Long Ladder. And this ties back to our comment earlier about clones. So there was this colony of individuals, and they were just making clones of each other, or clones, you know, basically the succeeding generations were just clones of the earlier individuals. But you started having these problems with later generation clones. And this is one of the problems with asexual reproduction. They called in the episode replicative fading, which honestly is better than the actual scientific term, which often, it's often referred to as Muller's ratchet in the science literature. But essentially, if you have a copy of a copy of a copy, if you can think of it just like a copier machine, the Xerox copier machine, if you make a copy of a copy of a copy, eventually you can't read it very well. Like some of the words will just get lost. That same kind of thing happens in the context of mutations. If you just produce a copy, the copy is not going to be absolutely perfect. You're going to have some changes in there. Changes are more likely to be bad than good. So if you just then take a copy of that one, you have all the mistakes from the previous one plus a few more, and all the mistakes from that one plus a few more as you go in further generations. So
I assume the word ladder was referring to the DNA helix?
I don't know. That's a good question. I was just thinking of it as iterative, but maybe.
I don't know. And what about Deep Space Nine?
Deep Space Nine, like I said, there's not a ton of biology there, but I mean, there were a couple of good medical episodes. So one called The Quickening was quite good in terms of this exploration of, you know, a pandemic happening, seems very timely now, and how they produced something which ended up being a vaccine, because they were able to put in these antigens that then helped the next generation fight it off. It was good. Voyager had a lot. Like I said, Voyager actually was hard to choose from. But as an evolutionary biologist, I'm going to pick the episode Distant Origin. That was one where they go to some planet and they find some descendants of ancient hadrosaurs from Earth.
Oh, yes.
And it was fascinating, too, because just the social message as well as science, like the science of how they figured out how they're related to humans on Earth was like dead on. I mean, they basically did what would be considered a phylogenetic analysis right now and looked at the relationships, and that was great. The resistance of some of the leaders in the Voth species to accepting that they're related to humans mimicked what we see here on Earth sometimes. So that was a great episode in general. Enterprise, I had a hard time picking one for that, even though there's a lot of good science references, but it's just kind of baked into the episodes as opposed to being like, you know, one heavy science episode. But one that was pretty good just in terms of having a lot of genetics to it was one called E Squared, where, you know, an Enterprise kind of from the future comes back, but it's essentially descendants of people on the ship. But again, the genetic testing and the analyses they do of of those individuals was spot on. You know, the description by Dr. Phlox of those was great. So I'm not going to say anything about Discovery because I'm going to feel like I'm bragging or something if I pick one. I wasn't involved in the earlier seasons of it though. But Discovery is good in that it actually tries. I mean, like I mentioned, there's one case where they did a really good job, but unfortunately there was something that they couldn't have anticipated. In the first season of Discovery, they talked about the tardigrade, this, you know, space tardigrade. And there was a mention, just a passing mention in there, saying, like its microscopic cousins on Earth, the tardigrade acquires some of its genes by horizontal gene transfer. Now, there was a paper, a very highly publicized paper from some researchers at UNC Chapel Hill, just down the street from me here, that talked about horizontal gene transfer in the tardigrade genome. And so this is like 2015, it's just a couple of years before Discovery came out. That was great. The problem is it turned out they were wrong. There were some papers the next year showing, no, that there were some errors in how the analysis was done. So it was a heroic effort and a great attempt. I mean, the fact that the writers tried to work something in from something that recent, two thumbs up to them, even though it ended up being a swing and a miss in that particular case.
Well, I could talk to you for hours on this subject, and perhaps we can have you back on the show again one day in the future to continue to talk Trek.
I'd love that.
Great. I can't wait. So what are you working on at the moment in the lab? And also, what's coming up on the BioTrekkie YouTube channel?
So the BioTrekkie with the Admiral series is on hold for right now because Jane, Brooke, and I were just going through season 3 of Star Trek Discovery. So we don't have anything imminent, but we're discussing whether we want to either go back and do seasons 1 and 2 or wait for season 4. So I'm not sure on that. On my other playlist called BioTrekkie Explains, I have an episode coming out very soon that talks about natural selection using the nanites from Star Trek The Next Generation. So that should be launched very, very soon. You should be able to catch that. In fact, maybe even before this video airs. In terms of the lab, we have a new grant from the National Science Foundation, big thanks to the National Science Foundation, to look at the genetic basis of lethality, right? So it's really interesting that most species that have been studied intensively, most individuals of each species have multiple or have one or more alleles that actually cause lethality, that essentially cause death before reaching reproductive age. Now, that seems counterintuitive because obviously we're alive. Like you and I are talking, how can we have lethal alleles? Well, these alleles tend to be genetically recessive, right? So what that means is if you have one copy, you're okay. But if you have two copies, that's when you get the bad effect. So this is well known to be quite common. This was studied actually for decades in the last century, especially in fruit flies, Drosophila species, which I work on.
Yes.
But last century, as we were talking about with regard to the Star Trek series, the genetics that were available then were much more limited than what's available now. So what my lab is doing now is coming back to this classic question, trying to understand both what are these genetic mutations that cause lethality and why are they so abundant? Why is it like you see so many of them? So one explanation for why they're so abundant is just there's so many genes that can mutate to cause lethality and mutation rates are high enough that just happens. And, you know, this is one of the reasons that you see inbreeding depression that, you know, I can have a kid with my wife because my wife's not at all related to me. She has some death alleles. I have some death alleles, but we don't have the same one. So our kids don't inherit too. If instead I had a kid with my sister, I don't have a sister, but if I had a kid with my sister, it's much more likely we'd have the same ones and therefore our kids would be bad off. So this is part of what causes inbreeding depression. So what we're doing now is we're trying to understand again, is it just that there's just so many of these mutations or is there potentially some benefit sometimes to having one copy of one of these alleles. So a classic example of this that's discussed often is sickle cell anemia. That if you have one copy of the sickle cell anemia allele, you don't have the disease, but you're actually resistant to malaria. Oh. So there's an advantage to having one copy, and that might allow that mutation to persist much more than you would expect, at least in populations where there's risk of malaria. So that's what we're looking at right now. We've had some progress where we've already identified a couple of these mutations themselves, which has been very exciting because, again, we have access to genome sequencing. We have access to a whole bunch of other genetic tools that were not available, say, in the 1960s and 70s when this was studied most intensively. But it's really exciting, and I love working with my team on these questions.
Sounds like fascinating work. I will leave links to your book, channel, and social media in the description below. And all that's left to say is thank you once again, Mohammed, for coming on to Evolution Soup.
Thank you for having me.